Good afternoon, welcome to TV5's brand new show, Young World. Today's topic for Young World again is Education 5.0. On Monday, in the Education 5.0 part 1, our panelists analyzed various emerging or future trends related to Education 5.0 and suggested that what needs to be done to adapt to the future scenario. Some of the suggestions from the panelists included allowing more private players into education, inverted classrooms, pushing institutions to go more digital, getting best leaders at the top like VCs, deans, etc., exposing students to hackathons, emphasis on soft skills, encouraging interdisciplinary approach, etc. In part two of today's episode, we have with us a very eminent panel, once again, comprising Professor Kali Raj, VC of Bharatiyar University, Dr. Shantanu Pal, CEO and MD, Talent Sprint, Professor Devi, Dean, Computer Science, Computer Applications Department, Head of Computer Applications Department, Bharatiyar University, and Dr. Som Datta Singh, Serial Entrepreneur and Ex-Chair, NASSCOM Product Council, Mr. Abhimanyu Saxena, Co-Founder, Scalar Academy, and Mr. Srikant Taluri, Head, DX Labs. So, we are going to seek the roadmap for finding the solutions to meet the demands of the industry 5.0 in today's panel from the panelists. So welcome all the panelists. We are lucky to have you all as panelists for today's panel discussion. I'll begin with Professor Kali Raj. He's Vice Chancellor of Bharatiyar University, and he was the former officiating Vice Chancellor of Anna University. He has got about 31 years of teaching and research experience. Good afternoon, Professor Kali Raj.
Good afternoon to all of you, and I am extremely happy that you made arrangements to start initiating the people to move towards Education 4. Now it is Education 5.
Yes, sir.
It's the right time due to the corona that we started using all these technology coming under your Education 4 and Education 5 technology. Industries 4 and 5, and our university is very keen to update whatever the curriculum we have today, which will be suitable for the industry's need for the last 10 years at least. And we would like to revamp the curriculum based on the need of the industries. When I talk about the industries, it's not only for the life science, medicine, and engineering department, even for the social science. Nowadays, you cannot discriminate between the science and humanities. We all work together, and there is a need for the involvement of humanities people to take the education to the society. And there also, we have to change the curriculum in such a way that the people who are coming out of any university, they should be employable, and they should be able to adopt modern technologies which will be suitable for the community as well as for the industry.
Right, sir. I'll come back to you, Professor, in a while. We have with us now Shantanu Pal. He is an entrepreneur, technocrat, and opinion writer. He is the co-founder and chief executive officer of Talent Sprint, a digital upskilling and boot camp platform for professionals in search of deep and disruptive skills. Hi, Shantanu. There's going to be huge demand for institutes like you, Talent Sprint, going ahead, because the students have to necessarily, in the post-COVID scenario, the students have to necessarily go for some add-on courses in addition to their regular degree, college courses or university degrees. So, but there aren't many institutes like you. There are hardly a handful of institutes in Hyderabad, and maybe some other institutes in other metro cities. In semi-urban and rural areas, of course, we can't find such institutes at all. So in this scenario, what do you think is the right path for the colleges, engineering colleges and the universities to offer the short term, the latest technology based courses like how Talent Sprint is offering?
Thank you, Vasant. It's a great honor. Thank you for organizing this, hosting this extremely pertinent topic. And I think building upon what Professor Kalidas already said, let me just say that to answer your question that I think the industry of, I would say, the education sector itself is going through some major transformations. It was already going through a transformation before COVID. I think COVID is going to really accelerate the transformation at a much higher degree, which we're already seeing in action. Now, let me give you three examples for the last 20 years, which will be very useful for us to think about. There was a time when a physical library was what we went to. We went to a physical library to go do research, collect information, gather, you know, answers to our important questions that we couldn't find otherwise. So library was a place to go. With the advent of online Google search or internet search, you know, the physical library kind of disappeared and we had the digital library. Today, we are used to finding our information, research, questions. We go to the online version of the library first. So we have a digital library that replaced the physical library. Then you had an idea that we used to always go to a store, a physical store, to buy, you know, our groceries, buy our needs, and buy our other household items and other things, even buying books. Well, subsequently, with the online e-tailing, we have learned how to basically forget about the physical store and think about digital store as the first point of call to look for things we want. Today, with COVID, I think a place like Big Basket lives because of the digital option. 5-6 years ago, we had this country went through big demonetization. At that point, a physical currency note got replaced by a digital currency note, which is now sitting on our phones in the form of a Google Pay or a Paytm kind of software, right? So one by one, we've seen the physical incarnations of important things become digital. And the physical assets becoming digital, the digital asset has become even more powerful, even more valuable, because its reach is enormous and its convenience is enormous. The same thing is going to happen to the classroom. I think what COVID-19 is showing is that the physical classroom, which people went to as a place to go to learn, will get replaced by this idea of going to a digital classroom or a digital platform where people will learn. So that's my basic philosophy about how the evolution is happening in terms of each and every physical asset being replaced by a digital asset, which is equally powerful, perhaps even more powerful than what was there before, right? To make a quick point about your question about what we are offering. Yes, today it's very clear that digital education is here to stay. It is not going to be a replacement of physical education with digital, even though COVID might give us that feeling right now. In reality, digital will be a major supplementer of physical education. And as Professor Kalidas said, we believe that the future of all universities is hybrid or blended. You will have a combination of offline and online experiences, or online and on-site experiences. And through a blended model, we'll be able to reach more people, teach more people, and make more people successful. And this is certainly true for colleges and college students.
So what could be the ratio? Like when you say it's a hybrid model, it's going to be a hybrid model, what kind of ratio can we see maybe in the foreseeable future, say next 2 to 3 years time frame, how much should be digital and how much should be the physical classrooms in case of universities like Bharatiyar and other universities and colleges?
Are you asking me that question?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. I think the answer is it depends. If you're a university and a college, I think you will see it digital. For example, if you are in executive education for working professionals, it will be 80% digital, 20% contact. If you are in college, it might be 50-50. If you are in a school, it might be 80-20, because we believe that as people get into more sort of an adult learning, senior learning, their ability to use technology, especially in terms of ease of use, the convenience of having good equipment, all of that, people have to have the equipment to attend those classes. So clearly, I think it could be 20-80 on the school side, 20% digital, 80% physical. And in executive education, it might be exactly the opposite, 80% digital, 20% physical.
Right, Shantan. So we have Somdatha Singh, Dr. Somdatha Singh. She has a PhD degree in economics and possesses 16 years of experience as a serial entrepreneur. She was vice chairperson NASSCOM Product Council earlier and a core committee member of Niti Aayog. So, hi, Som. So, day in and day out, we are hearing about so many job losses in various sectors in the coming days. So, the automobile industry, logistics, filmmaking, hospitality, tourism, etc., etc. In most of the sectors, we are going to witness huge job losses. In such a scenario, how should the students who are passing out of the education institutions expect the job market to be, and how to secure jobs if not all of the students cannot become serial or entrepreneurs like you? So what should be the course for them?
Absolutely. Vasan, that's a very good question you ask. And let me give you some statistics, right? We often think that the job market in India or elsewhere in the world is only concentrated to the physical workplace, which is not the truth. I run a pretty large e-commerce company. We have a lot of brands on Amazon. We sell a lot of, we manage a lot of big brands. Whenever we are looking for specialized skilled, or rather granular skilled, need-based talent, we go on to platforms like Upwork or Freework. Today, in the world which is so digitally interconnected, employment is no longer restricted to the walls of an office. Now with COVID-19, you have experience, and look at what we are using today. We are using Zoom to do TV interviews. My daughter is using Zoom to do her school classes because everything is happening on Zoom. People are now hiring on Zoom. People are not now managing their workplace on Zoom. So yes, it's true that the job market always sees ups and downs. It happened in 2008. It happened before that. It happened in the dot-com bust. It always is going to see ups and downs, which means that the regular jobs that you see today, Vasant, is gonna get replaced by specialized jobs. So let me give you an example. India right now is the highest, or rather the hotspot, to employ the best of design, content, UX and UI professionals. So if you go to a platform like Upwork, you will see almost 70% of the people who are there are from Indian descent, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and Southeast Asia. So before, India used to be the hotspot for ITITES, where people were outsourcing it, and it was only dependent on large organizations like an Infosys or a Wipro who would get those contracts, and then their employees would execute it. Now people are getting those contracts directly. And with the current COVID situation, where you will see a huge economic meltdown because of the kind of impact it has had, it will mean that there will be more doors that will open up for specialized skill. So given that, Shantanu said something very beautifully, that how physical assets are getting replaced with digital assets. Amazon has seen a 27% rise in new subscription base. So do you realize if this 27% rise has happened, which means there is 27% new employment opportunities that will come up as well? Because the more people that will come online to transact, the more logistics support you're going to need, the more fulfillment support you're going to need, the more warehouse support you're going to need. And therefore, while one channel may close down, there will be other channels that's going to open up. Given that the focus of this discussion is education 2.0, no longer people will just go and get an engineering degree. People will become UX, UI experts. People will become design experts. Now, movement of content is going to happen, more of people writing content for listing optimization. And there are such skills that are available today. So if you go, you can hire people who are Amazon ad experts, who are eBay PPC experts. So people's expertise and potential is getting mapped to the need and the transition that is going to happen from retail to e-commerce and more to digital in the coming days.
Right. You're right, Som. So you spoke about the kind of skill sets that are required in future for the students in terms of the job market. I'll come to Professor Devi now. She is a professor and head department of computer applications, Bharathiyar University, Coimbatore. So, good afternoon, Professor Devi. As an educational institution, Bharathiyar is relatively a step ahead in terms of gearing up for the challenges that are going to be posed by this Education 5.0. Apart from revising the syllabus and training your faculty for the new challenges, how are you planning to involve all the stakeholders to take forward in these steps that you are planning?
TV5 Rakshakalaku Namaskaramalo, Andriki Namaskaramalo. Special thanks to Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is driving Bharathiyar University Education 5.0 since October 2019. It is a world of smart and automation systems. Educational institutions have to handhold with the industries when we frame the syllabus. Already, Bharathiyar University has started working with TCS on cognitive systems, UiPath for process automation, and with Cognor for cybersecurity. The students should be exposed to industry right from day one of joining the Air Force. There are many students with creative thinking whose ability need to be tapped. Here, we are looking at interdisciplinary courses. Industry 4.0 and 5.0, if you look at the technology tools include robotics and automation, process automation, big data and analytics, cybersecurity, and so on. How can we integrate these industry 4.0 and 5.0 tools into every education, social science education, arts education, machine learning for economic policy, decision making? How can we integrate industry 4.0 and 5.0 into economics, into social work, into botany, into zoology? That is the challenge for the educational institution.
True.
And we have to handhold with the industries. Already Bhartiya University has started this. Under the leadership of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, we have planned a roadmap. How we have planned the roadmap is for ranking systems like NIRF, we submit the data. So as on date, where we stand. Suppose if I have to measure the research potential of Bhartiya University, how many patents are there? How many startups are there? In 5 years from now, how can we increase this number of patents? How can we increase this number of startups and incubation centers? Like that, we have to identify measures under student excellence, faculty excellence, infrastructure excellence, international exposure excellence, and so on. So under each excellence, the metrics or the parameters need to be listed. And then the first column will show the current value, where we are. 5 years from now, where we should be. And then 10 years from now, where we should be. This is the plan. Once this plan is developed, then we have to jot down the activities, list of activities to achieve those things. List the activities and then schedule the activities. We have done all this during Christmas holidays and Pongal holidays under the eminent leadership of Professor P. Kaliraj sir, and our Bhartiya University roadmap stands as a model for all other state universities, sir.
Right, Professor Devi. So you're talking about the incubation facilities that the university has to offer for the students, and the entrepreneurial development programs that you are planning there in the university. So we have with us Abhimanyu. Hi, Abhimanyu. The other day I had your interaction, one of your interactions in a webinar. You were talking about training 1 lakh Google quality engineers through your online university or virtual university. So what do you mean by Google quality engineers? That's question number one. And question number two, how do the students now, there is a mushrooming of the online platforms on internet. So how do students choose between these platforms without getting confused?
Right. So coming to the first question, that, you know, creating 100,000 engineers of Google quality, or, you know, to mean what we mean when we say someone of that quality. Having worked in, worked for some of the really good companies, Facebook, Google, etc. What our team collectively have seen is that, like, for example, while India has largest number of software engineers, despite that, Google is not a company created in India. Despite that, Facebook is not a company created in India. The core reason that we strongly believe is that we have been not able to provide training to our youth, which would enable them to create such large-scale product companies. The traditionally one big transformation, which other experts mentioned in this discussion as well, that in the new age, our students will have to be job ready and productive on day one. The traditional way where theoretical knowledge is accumulated and then companies hire and then there is retraining that happens at the job, that is not something that would be accepted in future. Particularly when in the post-COVID world, where, you know, we are expecting that people would be working from home, training, etc., might not be that feasible. So the education on the learning part has to be 100% aligned with what someone has to be doing at the job. When we say a Google quality engineer, it is simply an engineer who can think about product, who doesn't only have theoretical knowledge, but can actually build systems like, for example, WhatsApp, Google, Facebook, or at least some sub-components of that at that scale very quickly. Some of the things which we feel missing in our current training, and actually, unfortunately, even actually not much of it, not much of guidance is available even online for that. For example, building an application like WhatsApp is very easy. It is just as simple as me sending a message to you, which gets delivered to your mobile phone. However, imagine when this application has to be used by a billion people at the same time, and there might be tens of thousands of servers running in the background to support them, and building a system which can scale to that level, that is a capability that very few possess. And actually, you know, like there are very few opportunities to even get trained on that. Even the product thinking, the design thinking that Honorable Vice Chancellor was also talking about the other day, that are we training our youth to be able to come up with the solutions themselves? Someone shouldn't have to guide them. Someone shouldn't have to give them a task that this is a bug that you have to fix. But can they come look at the problems and build solutions for them themselves? This is what is, be it Google, be it Facebook, be it Uber, be it Flipkart. Through our discussions with them, these are the things that we see that these employers value a lot. And actually, if we can create abundance of tech talent who possess these capabilities, the economic boom of India would automatically come. If we look at US, if we look at China, their economic boom came only because they had abundance of talent. We have abundance of youth energy, but because of not having the right guidance, we are still facing a crunch of technical talent.
Vasant, okay. Can I add something to this?
Yeah, Abhimanyu, please go ahead.
Yeah, sure. I think Abhimanyu has hit upon a very, very important thread. I just want to add to this whole concept that, one thing that we've been doing also in the last year is that you may have read about this Google Talent Sprint Women Engineers program, where we have decided that jointly we will create between Google and us 600 world-class women engineers out of second-tier towns of India.
Right.
And surprisingly, to my utter surprise, this year when we put out the next 120 seats for applications, we got 15,000 applications, and we had to, run a multi-stage process to select 120. And I suspect that what even Abhimanyu is doing requires that level of selectivity. The point is that the aspiration among young students of this country, whether they're male or female, we are of course dealing with the women engineers only in this case, but aspiration is very high. The opportunities to learn are few, and the most important part that all of the speakers have mentioned, including Professor Devi, is that the learning has to be interdisciplinary and has to be integrated across multiple disciplines, and it has to actually have a very high experiential component. I think the important point that I cannot overemphasize, which Abhimanyu said, is that the problem with the learning is that learning has become a noun, but learning is actually a verb. Learning is not about what you know. Learning is about what you can do with it. And those who can build systems, create systems. So in other words, I always say that, Java, physics, chemistry are nouns, but writing, researching, publishing, coding, testing, deploying are verbs. People who have the verbs are the ones who will be really valued by the industry and the market, not the people who have the nouns.
I just want to add something to that, Vasant, with what Shantanu and Abhimanyu said is, but there that I also want to bring in a little important aspect to this, that post-COVID, it's not just going to be about building the youth of this country, which is almost 65% of the population, into just engineers alone. One of the things that is missing in our education is that you may build great engineers, but they never become thinkers, they never become entrepreneurial, they never are taught to basically experiment or, most importantly, research. The reason US, or even for the matter of fact, China, have always been ahead in the economic boom is because there was a lot of encouragement in the education for creative thinking as well. And that's what I think Professor Devi talked about.
Yes.
See, post-COVID, people are not just going to look for engineers to just do coding and all. They're going to look at solution experts who have creative thinking ability. So, why I even mentioned platforms like Upwork and all of that is self-employment will become key. People are not going to just go look for work under big umbrellas like a Google and a Microsoft. If Google has freeze its hiring. It's a global news. Google has stopped hiring. It's cut down on its ad expenses, on its innovation expenses, because everybody is going to start curtailing. So people are going to look at solution experts. Does our education system teach solution? Not necessarily. But I want to give you an example, because 4 years back, Mr. J. Chaudhary, you know, got me involved with IIDT, which is the Institute of, you know, Digital Education in Andhra Pradesh.
Yeah.
And they were looking at education that was focused on need and granular work-based education only. So they were doing 6 months and 1 year courses on analytics, because you know analytics is imperative. In today's world, no matter what you do, whether it's predictive, whether it's post, it's such an important part of it. In e-commerce, you look at analytics all the time before you want to even launch a new product. So if you look at education from a very granular, need-based, industry-focused only, the value that you will see, the quality of people who will get educated and get employed will be a lot higher. And I'm telling you, the mantra post-COVID to COVID-19 is going to be self-employment, is going to be people who are not going to be looking at, you know, going to workplaces to do jobs. They're going to be people who themselves will take up multiple projects and manage it. So to do that, you need more focused and more granular education system, more skills, but not just skills in terms of the exploited word skills, but knowledge that will allow industries to grow.
Yes, it's not going to be just the degree. And it's going to be the knowledge, the creative thinking, the design thinking is what the industry calls it. So these things are going to be much needed qualities in a job seeker. So we have with us, in fact, today's program is a true reflection of what's going to be post-COVID. So we have people from Bangalore joining us online. We have people from Chennai, Coimbatore joining us, Professor Kaliraj and Professor Devi. And we have a lone participant in our studio, physically present here along with me. And he's the only Telugu guy here, and the rest are all from the different languages. Mm-hmm. So, Srikanth, sorry, I came to you as a sixth participant. So, what's happening in the education world? Because new technologies are emerging every 3 to 12 mm-hmm. months, like you said earlier. Mm-hmm. And these are replacing the existing ones. So how can a 4 year engineering graduate, because he is studying some subjects which mm-hmm. were of course you have to be good at basics, but these were the subjects framed, the syllabus four was framed back. 4 years back, mm-hmm. and as you said, the new technologies are emerging every 3 months. Mm-hmm. So how can the students fill this gap?
First of all, I want to say hello to everyone, and this is being a very good discussion happening here. And the points raised by every
panel member. I forgot to introduce you. You are the founder of InCube and founder of Soil School of Interventional Leadership.
Innovation and Leadership.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Please.
So yes, I mean, like every panelist here, we have been discussing about the problem as a whole. Okay, what is the current situation? What is the situation that is going to be after COVID? So COVID tarvata prapancham ela untundi, and manaki last few years lo industry 4.0 ekku discuss chesam manu, and ippudu sudden ga 5.0 enti inka 4.0 complete avakunda ante, COVID is acting more like a catalyst.
True.
To transition, fast transition to 5.0. 4.0 lo manam ekku artificial intelligence, autonomy, process automation, ivanni large scale lo chedam anukunnam, but mobility, prapancham lo mobility anedi inka undindi. Now and going forward, Shantanu garu cheppinattu gani and professor garu cheppinattu, campus based ga eppudu malli manu elli reinstate cheyagaltam anedi doubt first. Dantho enante mode of delivery adi 80% 20% online high schools lo gaane undi college level lo ela elthundi anedi, that is a big question now.
True.
And a mode of delivery ki ippudu Zoom lantivi mana Google Classrooms lantivi unnai ventane vaartunnam, but vaatillo kuda chaala
right
ప్రాబ్లమ్స్ ఉన్నాయి మనకి అక్కడ, ఆ గ్యాప్స్ని ఫిల్ చేసుకోవాలి. సో అక్కడ లాట్ ఆఫ్ ఇన్నోవేషన్ ఈస్ వెయిటింగ్, అండ్ క్లాస్ రూమ్ ఎక్స్పీరియన్స్ని మనం రిఫ్లెక్ట్ చేయాలి 100% అని అంటే ఈ రోజున లేదు ఆ సిచ్యువేషన్. కొంచెం హయ్యర్ ఏజ్ గ్రూప్స్ ఉన్న వాళ్ళకి అది కొంచెం డిఫరెంట్ కానివ్వండి, హై స్కూల్ లెవెల్లో అది చాలా ప్రాబ్లం అవుతుంది. సో ఎడ్యుకేషన్ యాజ్ ఎ హోల్ చూస్తే మోడ్ ఆఫ్ డెలివరీ చాలా వేగంగా, మన లైక్ ఫాస్ట్ ర్యాపిడ్ ఇన్నోవేషన్ అనేది డెలివరీ కమ్యూనికేషన్ అండ్ కొలాబరేషన్ టూల్స్లో ఫస్ట్ రావాలి. నెక్స్ట్ సోమదత్త గారు చెప్పినట్టు అక్కడ మనకి ఆన్లైన్ జాబ్స్, అప్వర్క్, ఫ్రీలాన్సింగ్ ఇవి వస్తున్నాయి. ఎస్, ఆ స్కోప్లో చూస్తే మీకు ఇప్పుడు
గిగ్ ఎకానమీ అంటున్నాం ఇప్పుడు మనం,
గిగ్ ఎకానమీ ఎగ్జాక్ట్లీ. సో అప్వర్క్ ఇవన్నీ ఏంటంటే గిగ్ ఎకానమీ జాబ్స్, అండ్ ఈవెన్ ఆ ఏజ్ గ్రూప్లో ఉండే లేటెస్ట్ యంగ్స్టర్స్ అంతా దే ఆర్ ప్రిఫరింగ్ టు వర్క్ ఇన్ దాట్ మోడ్. అది మొబిలిటీ ఉన్న రోజున కూడా
వాళ్ళు టిపికల్ గా పొద్దున్నే 9 వెళ్ళి సాయంత్రం 6
దాకా కంపెనీకి
ఆ జాబ్స్ వాళ్ళకి ఇష్టం ఉండదు.
ఇష్టం ఉండదు వాళ్ళకి.
ఫ్రీలాన్స్ జాబ్స్
ఫ్రీలాన్స్ చేసుకోవాలి అండ్ వాళ్ళకి కెరియర్ ఫ్రీడమ్ అనేది ఒకటి ఉండాలి అండ్ ప్రపంచం అంతా తిరగాలి. ఇలాంటి మైండ్ సెట్ అది వాళ్ళకి ఏంటంటే దే హ్యావ్ డిఫరెంట్ ఎక్స్పోజర్ టు ద వరల్డ్ అంటే 2005 తర్వాత 2000 తర్వాత పుట్టిన వాళ్ళందరూ దే హ్యావ్ ఎ డిఫరెంట్ మైండ్ సెట్ బికాస్ వాళ్ళంతా డిజిటల్ నేటివ్స్. మన జనరేషన్ కానీ మన ముందు జనరేషన్ వీవర్ మైగ్రెంట్స్ టు ద డిజిటల్ వరల్డ్ అండ్ ఆల్ అండ్ గ్లోబల్ ఎక్స్పోజర్ చాలా డిఫరెంట్గా ఉండింది ఇంటర్నెట్ వల్ల వీళ్ళకి అండ్ యాక్సెస్ టు ద వర్క్ స్పేస్. మనకి అంతకుముందు మీకు ఇంటర్నెట్ ఒక వర్క్ స్పేస్ అనేది వైస్ ప్రెసిడెంట్ సిఎక్స్ఓ లెవెల్ ఉండే వాళ్ళకి 2000 ఆ టైంలో ఉండేది. ఈ రోజున ఈవెన్ లైక్ ఎల్కేజీ యూకేజీ పిల్లలు కూడా మనకి యూట్యూబ్ అండ్ బేస్డ్ లెర్నింగ్ వచ్చేసాము. సో ద కైండ్ ఆఫ్ మైండ్ సెట్ విచ్ ఈస్ ప్రివైలింగ్ ఈవెన్ అమాంగ్ ది యంగ్స్టర్స్ ఇట్స్ మ్యాచింగ్ యూనో ఇస్ ఇట్ మ్యాచింగ్ టు ద ఇండస్ట్రీ ఆర్ నాట్ అనేది ఒకటి పాయింట్. అండ్ ఇండస్ట్రీ రిక్వైర్మెంట్స్ చాలా డిఫరెంట్గా ఉన్నాయి. ఇప్పుడు ద వే ఇండస్ట్రీ ఈస్ ఎవాల్వింగ్ వాళ్ళ స్కిల్ రిక్వైర్మెంట్స్ కాంపిటెన్సీ ఎలాంటివి కావాలి ప్రాబ్లమ్ సాల్వింగ్ అనేది మాకు కావాలి అంటున్నారు. మనకున్న కరికులం నేను ఎక్కువ ఫోకస్ కరికులం డిజైన్ మీద పెడతానండి ఇక్కడ మనం ఎందుకంటే రెస్ట్ ఆఫ్ ద ప్యానలిస్ట్ దే హావ్ ఆల్రెడీ డిస్కస్డ్ యునో ద మోడ్ ఆఫ్ డెలివరీ అండ్ ద కైండ్ ఆఫ్ స్కిల్స్ దట్ షుడ్ యునో బి ఇంపార్టెడ్ అండ్ వాట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ ఆపర్చునిటీస్ ఎగ్జిస్ట్. సో వీటికి మ్యాచింగ్గా మన స్టూడెంట్స్ ఇప్పుడు లైక్ 65% ఆఫ్ ది యంగ్స్టర్స్ హు ఆర్ ఇన్ యూనో ఇన్ ఆల్రెడీ ఇన్ ద ఇండస్ట్రీ యాజ్ వెల్ అస్ హు ఆర్ అబౌట్ టు ఎంటర్ ద ఇండస్ట్రీ ఇన్ ద నెక్స్ట్ ఫ్యూ ఇయర్స్ వీళ్ళకి ఎలా మనం హౌ ఆర్ వీ గోయింగ్ టు ఇంపార్ట్ ది స్కిల్స్ అండ్ కాంపిటెన్స్ అనేది మోస్ట్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ థింగ్. అక్కడ కన్వర్జ్డ్ స్కిల్ సెట్స్ అంతకుముందు ఏంటంటే ఇంజనీరింగ్ అనేది ఒక సపరేట్ స్ట్రీమ్, ఆర్ట్స్ అనేది సపరేట్ స్ట్రీమ్, సైన్స్ అనేది ఒక సపరేట్ స్ట్రీమ్, మళ్ళీ మేనేజ్మెంట్ అనేది ఒక సపరేట్ స్ట్రీమ్ అండ్ ఆంటర్ప్రినర్షిప్ అంటే అది ఒక ఎలెక్టివ్.
ఓకే,
బట్ మనకి ఇప్పుడు ఇన్నోవేషన్ అంటే అన్ని కలిపితే ఇన్నోవేషన్, టెక్నాలజీ, మేనేజ్మెంట్, బిజినెస్, ఆంటర్ప్రినర్షిప్ ఫ్రేమ్వర్క్స్ ఇవన్నీ కలిపితే కానీ ఇన్నోవేషన్ అనేది బయటికి రాదు మనకి. సో ఇదంతా కలిపితే కన్వర్జ్డ్ స్కిల్ సెట్. రెండోది ఈ కన్వర్జ్ స్కిల్ సెట్ అనేది మన సిలబస్లో రిఫ్లెక్ట్ అవుతుందా లేదా, 4 ఏళ్ళు కూర్చొని వీళ్ళు చదివే సిలబస్లు అనేది ఉండాలి. ఓకే, లైక్ క్లాస్ రూమ్ యాక్టివిటీ బేసిక్ ఫ్రేమ్వర్క్స్ ఉండాలి. కానీ ఇప్పుడు హై స్కూల్ ఐ మీన్ స్టార్టింగ్ విత్ హై స్కూల్ ఇట్ సెల్ఫ్ దే ఆర్ హ్యావింగ్ ఆల్ ది ICT కరికులం అండ్ యూనో ఎంబెడెడ్ ఇన్ టు దేర్ యూనో హై స్కూల్ కరికులమ్స్ అండ్ ఆల్. సో బై ద టైమ్ దే ఆర్ రీచింగ్ ద అండర్ గ్రాడ్ లెవెల్ దే ఆర్ ఆల్రెడీ వెల్ వర్స్డ్ విత్ ద ఫ్రేమ్వర్క్స్ అండ్ ఆల్. సో దే ఆర్ లుకింగ్ మోర్ టు గెట్ ఎంగేజ్డ్ ఇన్ ద సొల్యూషన్ డిజైన్ అండ్ డెలివరీ. దట్స్ అ ప్రాబ్లమ్ సాల్వింగ్. అండ్ ఇక్కడ వాట్ ఎవర్ కరికులం దట్ వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు డిజైన్ ఆర్ దట్ షుడ్ బీ ఇన్ ప్లేస్ గోయింగ్ ఫార్వర్డ్ షుడ్ రిఫ్లెక్ట్ ద నీడ్స్ ఆఫ్ ద ఇండస్ట్రీ యాజ్ వెల్ అస్ ద బేస్ లైన్, కన్సిడర్ ద బేస్ లైన్ ఆఫ్ ద స్టూడెంట్స్ హు ఆర్ ఎంటరింగ్ ఇన్ టు ద స్ట్రీమ్. మనం వీ షుడ్ నాట్ అగైన్ స్టార్ట్ యునో డెలివరింగ్ ద లెక్చర్స్ అండ్ ఆల్ వేర్ దే ఆల్రెడీ యూనో హ్యాడ్ దట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ లెక్చర్స్ ఇన్ ద హై స్కూల్ అండ్ ఆల్ అండ్ దే ఆల్రెడీ స్టార్టెడ్ ప్రోగ్రామింగ్ యూనో అట్ ద ఏజ్ ఆఫ్ 9, 10, ఐ మీన్ 14, 15 అండ్ ఆల్. సో బాటమ్ లైన్ ఏంటంటే మనకి గోయింగ్ ఫార్వర్డ్ ఆర్ కరికులం షుడ్ బి మోర్ ఫోకస్డ్ ఆన్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ సాల్వింగ్ అండ్ యూనో కన్వర్జ్డ్ స్కిల్ సెట్. దానికి 4 ఇయర్స్ డిగ్రీస్ అనేవి ఐ డోంట్ థింక్ రెలవెంట్ ఎనీమోర్. మేబీ బీటెక్ లాంటి ప్రోగ్రామ్స్ ఆర్ అండర్ గ్రాడ్ ప్రోగ్రామ్స్ 2 to 3 ఇయర్స్లో కంప్లీట్ చేసేటట్టు ఉండాలి. 1 ఇయర్ మ్యాండేటరీ ఇండస్ట్రీ ఇంటర్న్షిప్స్ అనేవి ఎంబెడ్ చేయాలి కంపల్సరీ. డే 1 నుండి ఎస్ ప్రాజెక్ట్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ సాల్వింగ్ ఉండాలి. అది కాకుండా 3rd ఇయర్ ఆర్ ద ఫైనల్ ఇయర్ దే షుడ్ గెట్ ఇన్వాల్వ్డ్ ఇన్ అన్ ఇండస్ట్రీ ఇంటర్న్షిప్ అండ్ దట్ ఈస్ వెన్ దే విల్ అండర్స్టాండ్ రియల్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ లైక్ హౌ యునో మిస్టర్ శాంతను అండ్ అభిమన్యు వర్ మెన్షనింగ్ యూనో లార్జ్ స్కేల్ స్కేలింగ్ అప్ ఆఫ్ ద ఇన్ఫ్రాస్ట్రక్చర్స్ కానివ్వండి యాప్స్ కానివ్వండి రియల్ వరల్డ్ సినారియోస్ ఏంటి అనేది ఎక్స్పోజ్ అవుతాయి కానీ దే కాంట్ రియల్లీ లర్న్. అండ్ దిస్ ఈస్ ఆల్రెడీ హ్యాపెనింగ్ ఇన్ ద ఫీల్డ్ ఆఫ్ మెడిసిన్ కానివ్వండి, దిస్ ఈస్ హ్యాపెనింగ్ ఇన్ ద ఫీల్డ్ ఆఫ్ యూనో ద ప్రొఫెషనల్ సర్వీసెస్ లైక్ CA కంపెనీ సెక్రటరీస్ అండ్ అదర్ ప్రొఫెషనల్ సర్వీస్ దిస్ ఈస్ దేర్. బట్ వెన్ ఇట్ కమ్స్ టు యూనో ది ఇంజనీరింగ్ కానివ్వండి ఆర్ మేనేజ్మెంట్ స్టడీస్ అండ్ ఆల్ వీ సమ్వేర్ యూనో లాస్ట్ 20 ఇయర్స్ వాజ్ అ డిఫరెంట్ మార్కెట్. సో ఈ కరికులం అప్పుడు సరిపోయింది బట్ నౌ అండ్ గోయింగ్ ఫార్వర్డ్ ఐ డోంట్ థింక్ యూనో దిస్ కరికులం విల్ రియలీ సఫైస్ ద ఇండస్ట్రీ నీడ్స్ యాజ్ వెల్ యాజ్ యూనో ది ఇన్కల్కేట్ దట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ ఇన్నోవేషన్ అండ్ ఆంటర్ప్రినర్షిప్ మైండ్ సెట్ ఇన్ టు ది వర్క్ ఫోర్స్ యాజ్ అ హోల్. సో
రైట్, ఓకే శ్రీకాంత్, విత్ ది పర్మిషన్ ఆఫ్ అవర్ ప్యానలిస్ట్ కెన్ వీ టేక్ సమ్ క్వశ్చన్స్. సమ్ ఆఫ్ అవర్ వ్యూయర్స్ ఆర్ సెండింగ్ దేర్ ఈమెయిల్స్ అండ్ దే ఆర్ ఆస్కింగ్ ఫర్ సమ్ క్వెరీస్ టు బి క్లారిఫైడ్. సో ఐఎమ్ ట్రైంగ్ టు రీడ్ వన్ మెయిల్ ఫ్రమ్ రమేష్ బాబు VS. హీ ఈస్ ఆస్కింగ్ ఈజ్ అవర్ ఎగ్జిస్టింగ్ ఇన్ఫ్రాస్ట్రక్చర్ రెడీ ఫర్ ది డిజిటల్ క్లాస్ రూమ్ ఎన్విరాన్మెంట్. శాంతను, యు ఆర్ ది a proponent of this digital infrastructure, digital classrooms?
Yes, no, it's a great question. And it's a question that is the right time to ask this question as well, because almost by force, everybody has had to go to digital on overnight short notice. So I would say that, you know, the answer is surprisingly that a large part of the country is actually ready. You know, what has happened last 3 years is a huge proliferation of internet connectivity in this country in a very affordable manner, given some of the schemes we have seen and some of the companies we have seen. So recently, for example, some of the programs that we were running, which were significantly classroom component, had to go digital completely overnight. And to our surprise, the students and college students, they had gone back to their homes and all they had was a laptop or a phone. In some cases, even the laptop wasn't connecting well, the phone was connecting well. So when these people were attending classes from their home, we found 95% attendance, which really surprised us, because these are not students who are only urban. We had urban, semi-urban, rural students, and yet the attendance was about 95%.
Right.
The other thing that we should say is that, you know, there is actually ways of doing digital without having to worry about full connectivity availability. For example, one of the things we're doing now is every lecture that is provided online through a live class, like, for example, something like this, is recorded and made available through an AI-based technology for easy consumption offline. So a student can download the lecture and watch it, you know, without a connection on their phone as a video. So in directionally, the country is becoming more digitally connected, no question about it. So maybe we are 2 or 3 years behind before we have full connectivity. But until then, at least the phones, the phone packs, the data packs are giving us a lot of hope. And last but not the least, there are ways of compensating for this, even through creating asynchronous learning methods to back up the learning, synchronous learning methods.
Right,
Mr. Vasant, I would like to add something more for that.
Deviji.
I would like to share my screen.
Okay.
Can you see the screen?
Yeah.
Like the infrastructure, when we look at for taking the students towards readiness of Industry 5.0, already most of the institutions have smart classrooms. They have to have open source learning portals, and augmented reality based digital content will add a big value. There are many startups in India emerging in this area, mm-hmm. and we have to have a complete integrated enterprise resource planning system, mm-hmm. and digital transformation experiencing center is very, very essential. People were using computing labs, then we moved on to lab space. Now we are talking about experiencing centers, and we have to have digital placement training center. And in order to make the students with the skills for global competency and to have lifelong learning and uncertainty handling skills, we have to have a digital skill assessment center. Thank you.
Right, Professor Deviji. In fact, we have to, we are yet to perfect this technology aspect. Our guys have lost the video which you are trying to show. So I'll read another mail from Santosh. He is asking about what will happen to streams like mechanical engineering, because you are all saying IT, artificial intelligence, cloud computing, only these technologies will dominate in the future. So what will happen to the traditional courses like mechanical engineering, mechanical jobs, mechanical engineering? Professor Kalidas, any inputs on this?
Yeah, I'll be happy to answer this question.
Yeah, please go ahead, sir.
You cannot discriminate any of the subject, because all courses are available. It is not possible to delete any one of the course. And the only thing is, you have to incorporate the industry 5 related things like artificial intelligence, big data analytics, and various other things related to education 5 has to be incorporated into all the subjects. Without sociology, without economics, you cannot take the research finding to the society. The only thing is, it is very important to go for the prepared curriculum which will match the education 5. In Bhartiya University, we already started working on preparing the curriculum and syllabus on board with any one of the best curriculum suiting for the education 4 and 5. Number one.
One minute, sir. I'll come back to you, Professor Kalidas. There is some technical issue. There is some echo coming from your audio. Meanwhile, I'll try to seek this.
Can I answer the question also, add something to that?
Yeah, Shantanu. Yeah.
So I was just going to say that I think the Vice Chancellor's comments are absolutely appropriate, that you know, all disciplines have to be carried forward equally and supported.
Right.
But having said that, in the question, there is an assumption that mechanical engineering somehow is not in line with what's happening in the digital world.
True.
And I would submit that that's not true. The mechanical engineering world is moving even faster than many other worlds towards adoption and embracing. For
things
example,
like mechatronics and other things are happening.
Automobile engineers today, what are the two most important things that you care about in automobile engineering? There's electric cars and self-driving vehicles,
right?
One is battery technology and one is a computing technology, AI. So in other words, we are not going to talk about internal combustion engines for the rest of our lives, right? We will talk about engineering is itself changing and so is mechanical engineering. It's also becoming very digital. That's the point I was trying to make.
Right. Okay. So Manjushri is asking, in the education system there is no shortcut route, what is the situation for future generation? There are so many concerns that are being expressed by the young students who are watching this program. Stephen Murthy is saying speed for internet, digital, when you are talking about digital classes, internet speeds, the bandwidth, lack of bandwidth is going to be a major issue. For all this digital transformation we are talking about. So many inputs on that.
So, you know, Vasant, there is a challenge is why there is an opportunity, right? I always see that as two sides of the same coin.
True.
Think about India 4 years back and think about India where we are now. The reason today everybody is being able to connect and use technology, or rather innovations are being worked on, is purely because of the adversity that we are in right now. We're already, we're already going to see India do its 5G very, very soon. And I think internet connectivity in the next 1 year will see a robust amount of momentum. I think what challenge we will face is that how quickly our education system is being able to adapt to the changes that is happening, or the demands that is happening in terms of the industry. So that there you will see post COVID-19, there is going to be huge shift in the way industries are going to operate and the kind of talent that they're going to look for and the kind of education they're going to look at mapping to. So what Shantanu said, that the core concepts are not going to change, but the adoption of it, the way it is inculcated in the students, the methods that is used is going to change. And I think for the student community, what is an imperative, which I have seen, you know, every time I've gone to different universities to speak and all, I've seen our students are, you know, still not very well acquainted with what's happening outside in the world. Abhimanyu talked about, you know, creating Google quality engineers. The Google quality comes with a university that has an ambiance and an atmosphere to harvest innovation.
Right.
Most of our universities are producing job seekers. They are not creating job creators. And that is where the gap is. So online education is actually transforming that. It is making you so much more agile that you're quickly able to adapt to what the industry needs. And that is making you so much more acceptable to the current requirements. Let me give you a statistics. US has filed over 32 million unemployment. And they have just 1 year period to quickly transform that, which means a lot of, you will see a lot of people stopping, like, you know, movement of their employees onto offshore or on-site, job requirements, which means everything will happen within the country. One good thing is India will be able to retain a lot of talent because we have a lot of brain drain. Most of our, you know, the top companies in the world are led by Indians, but we Indians don't have that kind of a, you know, harvesting of talent here, but that's going to happen. That's an opportunity. With China's a lack of empathy towards the current COVID situation, a lot of manufacturing will move into India if we quickly build on capacity. So I really think there is a big transformation and an opportunity coming for India at large. Question is, can we quickly catapult and make ourselves aligned to that opportunity? Because we often get opportunities, but we do not have the infrastructure to support it. But hey, long story short, we do have internet connectivity. It's getting more momentum. There's a lot of innovation happening in interconnectivity, and there's a lot of fiber optics innovation that is happening. So I don't think that will be a challenge. Challenge is how quickly we are able to engage our students to become more more agile in the thought process of education.
Right. If Abhimanyu, if the manufacturing is going to move to India from China, like Som was saying, which are going to be the major sections of this manufacturing that will create a lot of job opportunities for our youngsters and for the upcoming admission season from the universities and college perspective, which courses should the aspirants choose mostly?
So in general, I have always been a big believer of that irrespective of stream, what really matters is are you the best skilled in that stream. That being said, definitely as Industry 4.0 you know, is just around the corner, and that's the reason why we also keep talking about Education 5.0, so that our students are prepared for Industry 5.0. Definitely the shift would be more and more towards automation. As I said earlier, that streams which are going to give you automation, of course, IT is also a part of automation within instrumentation, mechanical, etc. So courses which are more geared towards industry is definitely going to be more and more so. In few years, we might be seeing factories where there are no workers. But that doesn't mean that humans are not involved in setting up those industries or running those industries. With that, definitely data sciences, analytics, IT automation, instrumentation, robotics, all these fields, in my opinion, are going to see a lot of surge in the next 4 or 5 years. That being said, that that doesn't mean that other streams are going to get obsolete very soon. So much more pertinent is that our curriculum and even the students evolving and understanding the fact, as Som said, try to be a job creator, try to be a problem solver rather than just being a, you know, job seeker. You know, being at a place where you can build solutions for existing problems, that is the biggest job security. Being in a job is not really a job security. Your capabilities, your ability to solve problem is the real job security that one can have.
Right, Professor Kaliraj, you have, apart from the engineering, you have different disciplines in your university, the humanities, the arts and sciences, and where do you see a huge potential in the job market, because most of the students are job seekers. That's why I am again and again coming back to the jobs thing. So in your opinion, in your experience, which the discipline seems to be a good potential for the job seekers?
First of all, I would like to clarify one point regarding you know, all the participants were very particular about the students should be employable, not job seeker. I agree with all of you, because the type of curriculum and syllabus that we are having and we have been having for quite some time is a conventional one, and we have to go for the next level. So now the curriculum that we are going to prepare, that we already organized, that will be involvement of more of industries and stakeholders. They will be involved in the preparing curriculum itself, and also the students. The involvement of students in curriculum preparation is very, very important. Our governor, who is the chancellor of the university, is very particular about that. And after the curriculum and syllabus is prepared, this will be subject to evaluation by so many experts, including the stakeholders and all those things. And each course will be having at least 2 job-oriented certificate courses, which will be run by both university and also the industry, and more number of industry participation in teaching. And if you just think about what job will be, you know, job market will be, you know, more flourish or something like that, definitely the paramedical related one, according to me, has got a greater importance for that. Biotechnology is going to be there, and engineering is also going to be very important. But when the engineers are produced, and when you prepare the engineer, you just prepare them for the next 10 years, and they should be in a position to make themselves available for all types of available areas in such a way, you know, they'll be able to take up any job in the market. And we cannot discriminate the humanities. We have science and humanities, and also the computer science and management is very strong. And for making any one of the subject, like, you know, biotechnology or sociology or something, we need the support of the computer science people and management people, and to blend our curriculum in such a way that it will be suitable for all the institutes. So oil and gas industries, they are going to play an important role, and also the alternate energy, especially, you know, the solar, you know, energized materials, and the car which is going to run with, you know, alternate source of energy, and various other things. You have to think about what are the problem that we are having that has to be solved only by changing the curriculum. First of all, you have to make the people who are involved in preparing the strategy for education, like, you know, by chancellor and all, they have to be transformed, and the teachers have to be transformed, and they have to adapt themselves to the modern technology. And very recently we started working on the Skype meetings and Zoom meeting, and we are very comfortable, and we have involved so many industrialists and the experts from various countries for preparing our curriculum for MSc cybersecurity, and more of online courses, which is going to solve the problem of the gap between the conventional courses and the industries 4 and 5. You can also question a sociology department or the biotechnology department. They don't have the expertise for learning the education 4 and 5 related, you know, the courses like, you know, Internet of Things and, you know, artificial intelligence and all. But, you know, our people from our computer science, they are going to be involved in, you know, online education, not only from our own faculty, even they will be making arrangement of experts from throughout the world. I think the opportunities are going to be there for almost all the branches. It all depends on how you are taking, and you have to prepare yourself for the challenges, like what Soma has told.
Right,
that,
sir.
You have to prepare yourself.
Yeah. And so, in fact, we are running out of time. I'll give 1 minute each to all the panelists. Can you give a recipe or a suggestion to the regulators of the education and to the colleges and universities? What should be the roadmap for the education 5.0 that we are talking about? What kind of suggestions would you like to make? To begin with, from Shantanu.
Sure. Thank you, Vasant. That's a great question. I'll keep it very short. Yeah. I think a lot of our discussion today was about what we should teach, you know, subject curriculum redesign, etc. Those are, I think, very valuable to figure out what to teach. But I think one very important element of what we have to address is how to teach, right? The curriculum of computer science is the same in MIT as the same in the local engineering college. If you look at the table of contents, it looks exactly the same. The professor has the same lecture notes.
True.
But the outcomes are very different. And that's because how we teach has to change.
Yeah.
What we teach should be recall-based learning. We teach people some concepts, go out, and then actually conduct exams to test those concepts.
True.
We should be application. We have to create a culture where people learn by doing and not learn by listening. If our curriculum can revolve around learning by doing, learning by experiencing, rather than learning by reading and learning by memorizing, that is the transformation we need in the curriculum. It's not the content, it's how we teach.
Okay. Abhimanyu.
No, I would totally agree with Shantanu, sir, that experimental learning is very, very important. As a matter of fact, even at Scalar Academy, one thing we emphasized on day one is that after each class, there has to be hands-on assignment that people have to do. Apart from that, of course, in harder topics like engineering, etc., another thing we notice that the learners who are learning a new hard concept for the first time, it is very important that they are constantly corrected immediately when they are making a mistake or they are stuck at something. So having a virtual lab where whatever new concept they have been explained on, they are given problems to solve on that. And then their solutions are immediately either automatically or through a peer-to-peer review evaluated, and then further improvements are done on that. That pedagogy is extremely important. Mentorship is also something that we have seen is like creates exceptional large impact. Like even personally, I can say that things that I have been able to do so far is primarily rooted in mentorship. And even for learners, if let's say if a second year or third year college student, he is paired with someone who works at Google and has 4 years of experience,
right,
the probability of this person ending up at Google and creating much larger impact has already multiplied multiple times.
Okay, Abhimanyu.
So,
pedagogy and mentorship is what you are trying to highlight. Then
And with
Som,
data,
yeah, Som.
with data, we have seen that it creates a huge impact.
Okay. So, what's going to be your recommendation to the institutions?
We have such eminent and erudite experts on the panel when it comes to education. I'm going to add a little bit of the flavor of entrepreneurship to it, what I have seen and experienced personally. That you need to look at education in three dimensions. There is importance of technical education, there is importance of creative education, that is extremely important, and there is importance of business education. The reason a lot of engineers end up going and getting an MBA is because you can't take away the importance of knowing business and educating yourself in the dynamics of business. It's very, very essential. And so is creative and design thinking. The reason people from Stanford and MIT stand out, and Shantanu said, it's not that the stream of what is taught is different, it's the way that is taught is different, and they are also made to appreciate the importance of creative learning along with technical learning, which is something that institutions, universities, online education platforms have to harness. I want to say something to the students who are listening to this. Guys, don't just focus on what is taught to you in the university. Today, the reason, platforms like Talent Sprint, platforms like Skiller, all of that exist is go ahead and explore what industry experts have to offer you. Go ahead and explore what other forms of education, which is an add-on to what you're learning at your university, has to offer you. That is what holistic and wholesome education is all about. Co-learn, cross-learn, and sometimes unlearn to become experts or domain experts in a particular subject.
Right.
And stay strong. We are changing, and so is education.
Right. Very valid suggestion, Som and Srikant. What's going to be your suggestion?
So my take would be, we need to focus more on experiential learning or venture-based learning, how we term it. Start with, taking an idea and solving it from day one. And that will create, that multidisciplinary skill set and competency. Like we had IIIT doing that in the, in around like mid-90s and all.
Okay.
With having labs, industry-based labs, Oracle, Microsoft labs and all. So similarly now, we need to focus more on industry-centric learning rather than from the exam and mark-centric learning. How we do that is, yes, get the faculty or, the visiting faculty or adjunct faculties from industry. We have abundance of that talent now globally. People from Microsoft, Google, they're ready to contribute, for the country. And we're already doing that at Incube and Soil. So we have people from Microsoft,
right.
and other country,
okay.
Companies doing that. And partnered efforts between the learning ecosystems, universities, and, companies like Talent Sprint, Incube, and as such. Create those labs and all, and we have virtual labs everywhere. So we don't have to really come to a campus to do and collaborate on a problem-solving exercise.
Right.
And cut down the duration of the programs. We have to make sure, the students are industry-ready or the workforce are industry-ready.
We are completely run out of time. In fact, there's no break also in between. So thank you so much, all the panelists. We hope Professor Kaliraj and Professor Devi, you heard the experts, their suggestions and their recommendations and the kind of roadmap that they are indicating.
Yes.
So hope you will convey this to your curriculum team, whoever is designing the curriculums. And ma karyakramaniki chala mails vachayi. So all these mails will be individually answered through reply mails. Thanks for sending your mails. So idi ivalti Young World. Keep watching TV5.